It's good that so many people are here for the retrospective. So it's after lunch. So can you all stand up? You need some exercise, you know, otherwise you will be sleeping. Okay, so you can sit down if you never used any retrospective. Oh, okay. Then you can sit down if you feel that the retrospective is useless and a waste of time. Okay, at least some people, that's good. Well, good, not really. I hope you will change your mind and we do the exercise at the end. Okay, if you feel it's just some practice and it's good, but not the most important, you can sit down. And now, here we go. And I assume the people who are staying, they have the same feeling as I do, that the retrospective is the most important practice in Agile world, and not only Agile. Is that right? Okay, you can sit down now. Thank you. So that was the first cross-check, so I knew my audience. Well, how it started for me. It'll be about my journey, how I mastered retrospective, how I found out why is it so important for myself. It started, I've been working as a contractor in Minneapolis, US, and I realized it's a huge difference. They've got a traditional, huge corporation, waterfall-oriented, whatever. They've been sitting in a huge cubicles, don't talk to each other, don't sit next to each other. And after my second month there, when I started to get used to be alone in my cubicle doing the programming job, they switched to Scrum. So they said, well, now you know, you'll be doing the pair programming and you will be sitting in a lab, working together, help each other, talk to each other, and by the way, at the end of the sprint, there is a retrospective. It looks like that. We sit around the table and we send around Robin. And whoever got that toy, that person was supposed to say, okay, what I like and what I would like to improve. It was kind of an awkward American way of doing things. I was thinking at that time, sending some toy. Do we really need to send a toy to speak? It's really a strange thing. But it was a really, I haven't been the first one to get a toy. I've been sometime in the middle or whatever, sitting there and listening to my colleagues, which I saw a couple of times before during the status meetings, but not really knew them. And they didn't feel really good during that practice either. So they've been having a toy and speaking to the toy, something like, well, the toy, you know. So it looked like that. Well, you know, I think the whole pair programming is kind of a good thing, yeah, and I like that we are now sitting next to each other, and that's really good. And improve, well, no, I think it's kind of okay. And then pass it over there. And the other person said, well, you know, it's kind of a good and nothing really interesting going around, nothing really useful. And then it moved to my colleague, who was a contractor together with me from Prague as well. And he said, well, you know, I don't know what you really feel, but I hear a lot of complaints about not understanding the points estimation, and I hear a lot of complaints about this, this, and that, and he really named those particular problems which we've been facing. And from that time on, all the other American employees from that company have been saying, well, I totally agree what Lubos said, and that's really not working for us. And we would like to have some, you know, introduction about an explanation. So that was really a huge change, and that was my first retrospective. Not really best thing I ever can have, but there is at least some. Ah, now it is. So, the retrospective, which I learned later on, we call it reflection meeting, by the way, at that time. And I think it's going in a way that you realize that if you look into the mirror under some angle, you see something completely else. You see different people, you might see things from different angles. And the mirror is mostly virtual. So you would learn via the retrospective that there is no single truth. That there is no way which could make it, oh, it's this way because I've been here and I knew that our stand-up is long. There might be some other person who would be saying, well, I find it useful, and I like that it's so long because we have time to talk to each other and we can share experiences. And there might be someone else having completely different observations. So there is no one single truth. And so that's the beginning. You learn that there are different people having different ideas and different things. And then I passed some facilitation trainings which helped me to understand the dynamics of retrospective. And as everything which you facilitate, it's good to have an introduction. It's very short, very tiny piece of bit, 1 minute, 2 minutes maximum. You can say, okay, hello, we are now in retrospective, and you can do the check-in. So just imagine you are a weather. It's sleeping all the time. What kind of weather you would be? And those team members would say, well, I'm a sunshine. And the second one would say, well, I'm a mid-cloud weather. And then the next one would say, I'm just a thunderstorm. You don't know if that person who feels like a thunderstorm got a problem in work or in his personal life or just feeling tired because he'd been drinking last night. Doesn't matter. But just you need, okay, we might be a little bit careful and conscious about these guys because they are not really in their best mood. And maybe we can have fun from her because she's having a great day and she would smile anyway. And of course, you don't have to do it as a weather check. You can do what kind of car you would be. Ferrari or maybe Škoda, which is a Czech car, boring one. Or you might want to say just one word. Just tell me some one word about last sprint. Just single one word. And some might say fun. Some might say result. Some might say disaster or whatever else. So that's the first activity. Why is it so important? Because you let every one of your team members to speak up every first minute of that retrospective. They realize, oh, now I am at the retrospective. I should stop thinking about the coding, testing, whatever I've been doing until now, and focus on something else. I should stop, look back to the previous sprint, and think about it. So that's a kind of a psychological perspective of this check-in and introduction. The second step is to generate ideas. It's not about describing long stories, what I feel about that stand-up and that, Katy, she is always talking too long, and so on and so on. It's about identification of the problems, maybe, or areas, better, which we may want to discuss. And there are several ways, as I already mentioned, the round-robin circle and discussion and replying of the questions, what would you like and would like to continue with? And the second question is, what would you like to improve or change? That's a good one. I actually mastered it quite good. And it was working for me for a long, long time. It was good. Then I quit the company and started going around some other companies, helping them with understanding of Agile. And whenever we start Agile transformation, they often tend to say, first few sprints, there was nothing good. No, we didn't like it at all. It was horrible. And after 3 sprints later, they've been saying, well, we like this, 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 and that. Well, and there is nothing wrong. And I've got a hard time to explain it's not about good and wrong. It's just about things you can improve. And there is no ideal team. You will never be perfect team ever, anyway. And one of the team who, when I've been still working for my previous company, been saying we are a great team. We don't have to do the retrospective because we are the best team in this company, they said. I was kind of curious if they are. I've got some indication that they are not such a good team. So I said, well, maybe you are. And maybe there is really nothing to improve and nothing to get better, but let's do it this way. Let's do this timeline. And let's put it on a wall next to where you sit. And anytime anything happens during the next sprint, you will mark a note and place it here on the wall. And then when we go for the retrospective, we bring it there and discuss those small events. And I ask the Scrum Master to write the first sticker, just in case they would not. So when I come at the end of the sprint, I saw the full board of the cards. There's a lot of funny things and not so much. So we bring it to the retrospective meeting room, and I draw those two signs, if you like it or dislike it. And the team members would do kind of a dot voting for every card, saying three people likes that thing, and one people dislike it. And maybe there is some other which were liked by all of them. So at least we have a very fast, some kind of idea how it is, if they really like it or not, or what it was about. And surprisingly for me at that time, because it was an experiment with this format, it worked very well. And they realized, even for them, as the best team in the company, the retrospective is really useful. So that's one thing you can use. Then a couple years after that experience, I've been at a company and we've been running a Scrum on an Agile transformation group. So we've been saying we are teaching the company how to adopt Agile and Scrum, and we would like to use Scrum for that activity. So we are doing the retrospectives. And I joined that group, and that Belgium guy, he said, well, we do the normal retrospective, so I expected to run Robin thing with the sitting, and he drew that star and said, okay, well, identify the thing which you would like to start with that's on the top. And something which you would like to do less or more or continue with or even stop. And I was thinking, well, how that could work. But then I realized it's one of the most powerful concepts, how to gather data and how to get areas for discussion. And the reason why is that it's not just people are like good and bad. It looks at your life from a different perspective and different angles. And you can involve the team again. So there is a check-in to involve a team right away. They enter the door and the meeting starts. And there is this star which involves them again, right away. So what I now do, I ask every one of the team members, can you please write a note, one, two, maximum three words for one card, to identify areas you would like to discuss. And of course, once you are done, please use a marker so we can all read it. And once you are done, please stand up, go to the wall, and place it here and read it loud. So for example, I would like to stop having long stand-up meetings. And that's all that the person leaves. Or he can, of course, put more there. The good thing is that during the whole retrospective, you see your own handwriting, which is psychological perspective, it's yours, it's not mine anymore. I just draw the star for you, but you are doing the content, which is good. Second thing is that you can directly connect the same things or similar things together, like it's over there on the top. So you can connect those things together and say yourself, okay, we feel as a team that these two cards belong together, and they are pretty much talking about the same area. So that's a good thing. So the ownership for the retrospective is already in the hands of a team, which you as a facilitator and Scrum Master would like to achieve for the first place. I've been sometimes ending up having a round robin thing, writing notes and then reading it again, and then the people are saying, what was there again? I don't remember what he said or what she said, or is there anything else? They've been kind of disconnected. With this, they almost never disconnect. And I think that the goal is to make it different. So every single retrospective is good to make a difference. Sometimes you can do the star, the same one as from the previous picture, but focus it just on the testing. Because testing is with us during our retrospectives from the very beginning. So we focus it on the testing only. Or you can be even more creative. So if you Google it, you will find out that you can draw a boat. So there are some anchors which just draws you down. So if you put a sticker note and place it here, it's a huge problem. If you place it up here, it's a smaller problem, by the way. And there are some winds up there which makes you move forward and which makes you go faster. And you would find out that those categories which you put there doesn't necessarily have to be even complementary. So my favorite question for advanced retrospective, let's say, is what makes you smile? So whatever makes you smile, put inside that face. And whatever you don't like or feel sad about or feel it should be improved, put as far away as you could. It's not about good and bad. It's always about when I first draw it and say what makes you smile, they always start smiling and say, well, was there anything funny? Ha ha ha. But for some reasons, I told me recently, some of these guys, that from the time you said what makes you smile, I still keep thinking, what was the most funny thing during the last sprint? So it brings positivity. And the positivity is one of the most important things. I will tell about it a bit later still, but keep it in mind somewhere. So be creative. Do different drawing, different categories, different way of moderating retrospective every time. Otherwise, it starts to be boring. And we are talking about the same things, and there is nothing new. And, well, the retrospective, they say, been very useful for us at the very beginning, but I don't know, after 10 sprints, there is no value in it anymore, so we stopped just doing it. So you don't want to be there. Retrospective is something which is the most important. And I have a couple of pictures from my clients, what they did. So there is one where they say the two faces make them a bit funny. So the team would smile and say, okay, well, that's the guy who is smiling and that's the guy who is crying. Or they draw that boat, which I have been speaking about. So that's the second thing. Again, in real life, it looks like that. And then my favorite is this one. They said, well, you know, me as a Scrum Master, she said, I start drawing that car, and then the whole team came in and joined me in drawing, and then they draw the wall which we can hit, and this parachute to stop it, and so on and so on. You can even see the different colors of that drawing. So the whole team kind of helped the Scrum Master to create such a drawing. So that's the real self-organized team who embraced Agile and Scrum and retrospective. So let's move on. As I already said, it's quite easy to group those ideas because you don't have to do it yourself. You can just say, well, okay, do you think there are some areas identified already on the board which connects to each other? Do you agree? Okay, so let's move it. Let's put it together, let's stick it, and the people do it themselves. You don't have to do it as a Scrum Master anymore, which is cool. As a Scrum Master, you are mostly sitting there and let the team did the job for you. Then the second good thing is the dot voting. So I don't know if you're all familiar, but let's make it fast for those who may not. The dot voting works in a way that you give a marker and say every one of you has three dots. So you can do one dot here, and one dot here, in case you feel these are the most three important things for you. Or you might want to say, well, this is the most important thing for me, so I put all three dots here, which is, by the way, the most powerful thing. So if you want to influence the group the most, put all three dots somewhere. That's just one thing you can do. So in a minute or so, you directly see what is the most important for the team. And you can start with that area, exploring, and getting more insights, and generating options. So that's the third step. So these two steps were kind of a very, very fast introduction. check-in, generating areas. That should not take long. The ideal time for retrospective is about 1 hour. In 1 hour, if you do it regularly, you can do a lot. It's quite good. So, what you do here, you spend most of your time, well, most of your time, generating options for this area, because that's got 5 votes. Then some on the other, which has 4, then some on the 2. And you may even skip some of those areas. You don't have to go through all of them. So that's one of the good things. So how to generate the options? It's usually, I start with a question. Okay, so what you can do about it? And usually it's enough. Stand up is long. Okay, so what you can do about it? We can speak less, we can put a timer, we can put a bell and ring a bell anytime anyone starts being long. We can, you as a Scrum Master can do some refreshment about what's the stand up about and some other options. So it's going wide. There is no right and wrong. We just try to generate as much options we may possibly use as we can. And sometimes it's not enough. Sometimes you need to understand better the problem, the area. So you might use this fishbone, and it's about digging more into what is the problem, where it usually happens, who is involved, and who can influence it in both negative and positive way. Why is that happening? And when? And once you understand it, you are most likely ready to generate the options. For me, it's this fishbone is too complicated. I almost never are able to remember those 5 things. So I use 5 whys. It's easier. And the thing is, the same as the previous concept, you're asking for a root cause. It's not just like, why is too long? Well, because we are speaking too much. Okay, so it's not really helping. Okay, so why do we speak too much? And so on, until you finally realize what's the real root cause. The kids are good at asking why, by the way. But it's a good practice. Try it once, and you will find out, you'll be surprised what's hidden behind it. So the next step, 4th step already, the most important thing is, whenever you generate the list of options here, I'm always asking, okay, so what are you going to do next sprint? What are you going to finish, really, next sprint? And of course, before I make sure that there are concrete action items, it's not like, well, we will help each other. So it should be concrete, it should be for one team member. So even though this could be the product owner is not really working well, and the product owner is a problem for us as a team members, the options might be saying something like, well, product owner should do his job better, or we should tell him to prepare backlog better, or maybe we may do a more grooming and invite him, or we may just explain him and reveal to him that we have this problem. So that's all good, but if you end up with an action item which would say product owner should change his way of doing backlog or should improve his backlog, well, that's very nice, but product owner is, unless he's sitting there and it's his commitment, it's pointless. So it should be something which says, well, Ella, we'll go to the product owner and try to explain him or her that we need a higher quality backlog and how to achieve it. Maybe it helps, maybe not, but we'll see. At least we, as a team, make some action. And it's quite concrete, it's measurable. We can decide if it helps or not. I see quite often at the retrospective something like, to all team, we would make sure that the stand-ups are shorter. And to all team, we would make sure that we plan reasonable commitments for the sprint. And to all team members, we will help each other. And we will cooperate more. And at the end of the beginning of the next retrospective, they are like trying to go through those items, not anymore action items, and saying, did we do that? Well, yeah, we helped each other a bit, yes, I guess, but I don't know if we can mark it done or not. So that's wrong from the very beginning. If you would help, if you would like to help each other, just select an option, which is an action item, which might be every sprint planning, we will find at least one person who would do the pair programming with someone on one user story for sprint to learn something new. It could be one person per sprint on one user story, or it could be more, I don't mind, but it should be something which you truly believe you will make done. The good thing on those stickers is that once you do it visually on the board, you can just distribute those stickers over there from action items to the people, and they place it on the Scrum board so they see it. And then you don't have to go through it every sprint retrospective again if it's done, because you see it every day during the stand-up and you move it through your board. That's kind of a good on the physical thing. And so, so the end is action items. 80%, there was some study, they said that 80% of the action items should go inside to the team and not Scrum Master. And I would say that 100% should go for the team members. Well, Scrum Master may help time to time, but it should go to the team members. And there is something which you may be doing on top of the retrospective. It's kind of a team health meter. It's good to know how are we going as a team. So you can use several things. One of them is an Iconico board where you have a table with a team members' names, and every day you draw some picture for you. So you came to the work before the stand-up, you draw a picture. So everyone see how you feel that day. And sometimes the people start asking even, okay, can I help you? Because I see from your picture that you are stressed. What can I do for you? And the Scrum Master directly see if the team is kind of a good or not feeling such good. And the most important thing is a positivity wall, positivity itself. So the teams which are having more positivity things than negative are more successful. There is lots of studies about that. And one way is to encourage the people to explain in the retrospective their feelings about what went well and what is good, and so on. So they put those things there. Or the other one is to create such a positivity ball so you see it. Every day you have it in front of you. No bugs, sprint results were good. Well, we went on Friday for a beer, and by the way, I've been on holiday, so that's cool. So it's something which you, once you see it, it just brings higher energy, and it's much better. And finally, the last step of a retrospective, it's a closing. Again, it seems to be not important the same way as the opening introduction at the beginning, but it's very important. It helps you to look through that visualization again and think about the action items which you are going to do. And it really reminds you that, okay, I promised to the team members here around me that I will make sure that we split all user stories into the one-day tasks. It doesn't mean I will do it myself. It just means I'll make sure that you do it. And we all agree on that. So that's kind of a closing thing. Again, 1 minute, don't make it formal. If you are having a retrospective in a meeting room, bring that flip chart to your room where you're working so you see it all the time. all the day, all the sprint, next sprint. That's a good thing. So that's all pretty much about the retrospective, when the team is working reasonably good. And now, have you ever seen a team, or have you been ever working in a team where everyone was quiet, looking down? They don't even reply for anything you ask. We don't know. No, it's good. No, we have a good product. I do the programming. I don't care about the rest. So it's very hard to do a retrospective in such an environment, and there is a few concepts which I would like to share with you. One is this. You can draw such a picture or similar on a flip chart and put it on the doors, on a meeting room where the people enter the room, and put a lot of stickers. So they can place a sticker on a quadrant which they feel to be. The explorer, that's someone who you love to have at retrospective, that's someone who is active, who said, I want to get new insights, and I want to change things. And I will be very active, and I will be telling you what I feel, and I will be taking action items, by the way, because I want to improve not only myself, but us as a team. So that's wonderful. If you have the room full of explorers, that's awesome. Then you have the shoppers. That's the people who are coming to the retrospective with their cart and saying, well, you know, retrospective is kind of a boring, but, well, yeah, I know it's part of the Scrum, and we now do Scrum. And, yeah, there are sometimes good ideas coming from retrospective, so I'm here, and I'm sitting here and listening. And sometimes I get something new, interesting, so I put it in my cart. They are not really negative, but they are not really active or proactive. They will not help you much, but it's not too bad still. So we have vacationers. That's cool. They feel, oh, this is great. I don't have to work. I can sit in this meeting and take rest. Well, they are still not destroying the meeting. They are just don't care so much. And the last one, they are the prisoners. So you find it quite well, because they are sitting like this. And when you ask them something like, I don't know. I just have to be here. And I don't like the Scrum, it's just about the meetings. So, that's the prisoners. They just have to be there. So, sometimes I just ask them, okay, if you don't want to be here, here are the reasons why, and why we would like to be, you to be here, but if you don't, here are the doors, you can leave. 90% of the people will not leave, surprisingly, I learned. But, yeah, there is some percentage. So this is more safe to just put it here. And if you have a full team, full room of prisoners, you can use it for any other meeting than retrospective. But let's now assume it's a retrospective meeting full of prisoners. Just forget on your retrospective. And start working on the reason why they feel as a prisoners and what you can do about it, because otherwise, if you move them even there or there, at least, retrospective would be useless anyway. But sometimes even revealing that I feel as a prisoner, and I don't like it, because no one likes to be prisoner, helps, surprisingly. And there is another thing which I use after we find out that we have a lot of prisoners there. It's called Design Partnership Alliance. And it's a concept, so you do this flip chart again. And I usually start with revealing what I see. So I say, well, you know, it doesn't look really good, this team. It doesn't look like you have a fun. And why are you even here? And, you know, I would not like to work here in this team. And they're kind of, I guess they finally agree with me. So they say, well, yeah, I know, but it's not so bad. And it's already a good move. So I say, okay, so let's imagine. Let's tell me something about your values. How would you recognize a good team? How it would look like? And it's difficult at the beginning, but after some time they start saying, okay, it's about the good communication and interesting product or whatever have in mind. That's quite general, so it's quite easy to get those things out of them. And then the second question and biggest part of the flip chart, let's say, is saying, what makes you flourish? What makes you the best team ever? What is for you? What makes you the best team? And then they start to be more concrete and putting up those things, we help each other in here, and this is good thing as well, and that is good thing as well, and after all, we are doing a very good job here and very good job there. And once we are done with that part, we say, well, but you know, there's the ideal case. So what you would do as a team when things go difficult, when you've got the problems? So, for example, you said here you will help each other and you will not keep that one single tester be testing all your product for the last day of the sprint, so you would help him. But what if there is a sprint and you are all saying, well, you know, we are developers, we are done. And that tester is still sitting there saying, like, okay, I do my best to do it, but I still can't. So what are the triggers, how you recognize it, and what are you going to do about that situation? What are your fears and how to improve it? And then there is accountability. That's the last thing. I always encourage them to take, every one of them, take one thing as a commitment from those things. I will make sure that this will not happen. It's not a big thing. It's just, I'll remind everyone that we agree that we will help that tester or something like that. And it's usually a thing that surprisingly helps a team being out of prisoners to really take responsibility of their own process. So it's about change. And the retrospective, my feeling is that the retrospective helps us from individual team person one who feel, okay, we are a group of people, we are working on same project, but I do this, into the agile way of working, well, we as a team will do it this way. And we as a team do that. So it's about a change of perception, change of values, change of these things. And it's about responsibility. And I don't know if you are familiar with this diagram. It's well, it's my drawing, so you haven't seen it. But Christopher Avery is a person from Texas. And he created that concept. And he said that people's brain is kind of a problematic thing. It has hard-coded here that whenever there is some problem, even tiny one, it just automatically goes to denial. So if I park in a garage and accidentally, once I'm parking, I just crashed into another car, I can deny it. I can say that's the first thing which my brain would offer. Well, you know, it never happened. Well, that the scratch has been already there, or I haven't seen any scratches at all. It's good. If you feel not so good about that thing, you can do lay blame. You can say, it's his fault, because he parked not really straight. If he parked right away, I would never crash to him. It's not my fault, it's his fault. So that's the second stage. If you don't like it for some reason, you can do the justify. You can say, well, it can happen to anybody. You know, it happens time to time. When the people park in a garage, there is a very narrow space. Do you agree? Yeah, it happens. It's normal. There's not a problem. Well, or you can say, it's a shame, so I'm not good enough. I never park in the right way. I always crash to someone. It's, I am a bad driver. It's not a responsibility still, but that's one, two, three, fourth stage. The fifth stage is obligation. Well, you know, I give him my business card so he can call me and my insurance company will take care, because I have to. Or you might quit anytime you like. You might quit from that process and say, I don't want to take care about it. It's too little to even care. And if you really, truly want to be responsible, you would say, okay, what I am going to do about it? What I am going to change? And you might generate options. You might want to say, well, I might train at a parking lot, empty parking lot with paper boxes. Or I might stop parking in those tiny spaces. Or I might take some driving school to teach me how to better park or whatever else. But it's about what I do. And that's the same thing which the retrospective is teaching to the people. Okay, it's very easy to say our manager is not doing a good job, or it's easy to say our product owner is poor. We have a bad backlog, otherwise we would be a wonderful team. But the real responsibility which we try to achieve via the retrospective is, well, what we as a team members will do about it. So we will go to the product owner and try to explain him or help him to create a better backlog. Or we go to our manager and try to talk to him. Maybe it helps, maybe not. But that's life, yes? I can do the driving lessons and still can crash into the car, but at least I do something. And then I reflect and do something else. And last thing for you, the retrospective helps you not to end up as a frog. Do you know that story? The frog is a very smart animal. It's the top of my drawing, you know, I've never been able to draw anything, so I decided to draw a frog. So if the frog sees a pot with a boiling water, it will never ever jump into it. And if you throw it into the water, she will immediately jump off. It's safe. But if you put a frog into the pot with a cold water and start the heating below, it will stay there and be boiled. And the people are exactly the same. So I hear a lot of the time something like, you know, we don't have to do the retrospective because we talk to each other. We would tell each other if we have any problem or if we need to improve, we discuss right away. But maybe they end up as a frogs. So the retrospective is here to save you from that. And that's my last slide. It's me, if you don't recognize me with a colorful hair. And if you have any questions, we have still 2 minutes, I guess.
Any questions? And? No? Everything is clear?
Okay, so if you have any questions later, I'll be sitting somewhere outside or you'll see me around.
Oh, ah, okay. There is one. Sorry.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask about the process where you evaluate the good or bad things during the retrospective with the dots. Mm-hmm. And then you pick the ones which you should spur the take the attention into. Uh-huh. So is it only about the bad things or does it apply for good things as well?
Well, the question is usually put a dot there into the area which you would like to discuss. So it could be a good thing which we want to improve, right. Or it could be a bad thing which we want to change. It depends. Usually it's about improvements, but it could be, okay, we've been at the pub on Fridays and we agreed we will go every other Friday, but I think it's a good thing, but I think we should improve it in a way that every other Friday we go for bowling and then other Friday for a beer or something.
So if everybody likes to go to the pub, you would spend more time organizing those pubs than you would spend time solving existing issues which got 1 point each, say?
Well, if the team feels it's the most important for them, they must have a reason. And it's about you as a Scrum Master to facilitate that discussion so they realize it. So what I do, I don't let them to leave and kind of say, oh, we are just talking about the pub. So it's really exact questions. It's about, okay, what you would like to improve and how exactly? And if there is nothing, that's okay. Is there anything we would like to discuss on the pub yet? If no, we can move to another one. So, yeah.
Okay, maybe one more last question. No?
Over there.
I don't see, actually.
At the retrospective? Or in general? In the retrospective,
maybe you can repeat.
Oh, yeah. Question. What's the most common mistake the Scrum Master can do at the retrospective? So I think the most common mistake is to come with a solution or come with the problems in your head and don't listen. At the retrospective, you are a facilitator, so you're responsible for the format of the discussion and for the discussion itself, but not for the content. So if I come to the retrospective and say, well, you know, guys, we haven't been finished this sprint commitment, and our stand-ups are too long, and our product owner is not having the right priorities, so let's discuss this one by one. So what do you think about the first item? Oh, this. Okay, so how about if we do this? Do you agree? Yes, we do. So that's not the thing which you should do. Come with empty mind, okay?
Thank you, Zuzi. I see people have questions, but we have
okay,
a short
outside,
break.
Please.
Yeah, please.
Thank you very much.